As we look farther into the universe than ever before, we may be looking deeper inside ourselves.
One of the most surprising facts about our relationship with the larger solar system we live in is that the organics in our body were most likely brought here to Earth on comets and asteroids.
Rich in molecules called nucleobases, the same molecules that make up our DNA, asteroids could be the key to unlocking the mystery of life on Earth.
And maybe the very origin of your body, of the chemistry that you're using to watch TV right now, came from the asteroids.
One asteroid is especially intriguing. Its name, Bennu.
In the case of Bennu, it's about a half a kilometer across rock.
Bennu itself is an exciting object. It's a carbonaceous asteroid. Carbonaceous means that it contains the element carbon, which, as we all know, are associated with life.
Bashar Riz is a scientist at the University of Arizona. But it's not just the possibilities of life that makes Bennu interesting to Bashar. It's also the possibility of death.
Bennu is a class of asteroids that share the same region of space as the Earth as they move around the Sun. Every 6 years, it's in the same general region as the Earth. That increases the opportunity that it would actually hit the Earth and cause damage.
To understand whether Bennu truly poses a risk to Earth, we need to see it. In the mountains outside Tucson, Arizona, Eric Christensen searches the skies above Earth for asteroids and comets.
This object that's circled in red here in the middle, it looks like a faint star, but it just happens to be the asteroid Bennu.
The Catalina Sky Survey is our first line of defense against asteroid impacts.
Asteroid impacts are really a fact of life. They always happen, they have always happened, they will always continue to happen. We will point our telescope at a particular area of the sky, and we will build up over time, essentially a very low-resolution movie. We can compare the images and identify stars that are stationary, and then anything that is not stationary is a potential moving object.
When astronomers discovered Bennu, they quickly realized that of all the near-Earth objects in their sights, this asteroid has one of the highest chances of impacting Earth.
Bennu had come near the Earth near enough that we could get radar reflection off of it, and therefore we know something about its shape.
To fully understand where Bennu is going, Peter and Bashar need more than just fuzzy radar images. So in September 2016, they will launch a spacecraft called OSIRIS-REx. After 2 years of traveling through space, it will intercept the asteroid. Once there, its mission is twofold. OSIRIS-REx will collect a sample of the asteroid to return to Earth, and it will photograph the entire surface in extreme resolution, taking pictures down to the size of a pebble.
Our cameras will go and try to characterize the asteroid's environment. We're going to image this object to a higher degree of resolution over a larger piece of its terrain than has ever been done before. Mapping Bennu with these cameras is essential because we'll understand the gravity of this object to a much more precise degree. Predicting where this object will be 100 years into the future is very important because this is one of the potentially most hazardous objects in the solar system for the Earth.
To precisely determine Bennu's future orbit, scientists need to know the asteroid's exact size and shape. That's because of a phenomenon known as the Yarkovsky effect.
Any object in the solar system experiences the Yarkovsky effect. Now, what is it? Well, it's a thermal asymmetry that happens because of the rotation of an object.
As the sun's energy strikes Bennu, it gradually changes the asteroid's orbit.
Things have had a chance to heat up. Now, when something is hot, it tends to emit photons, thermal ones. Photons carry momentum. So what this is doing is acting like a little bit of a thrust in this direction. If I thrust that way, I'm kind of increasing the energy of the orbit and moving it out from the sun a little bit.
The high-resolution images from OSIRIS-REx will tell the team exactly how the Yarkovsky effect is influencing Bennu's path.
If an object the size of Bennu struck the Earth, it would be a regional catastrophe, perhaps taking out as much as a state or several states.
It could cause a lot of damage and the loss of a lot of life.
Space is all about exploration, and it's something that we humans seem to kind of be wired with. History has shown that you've got two choices. You can either keep marching ahead, or you can fall behind and end up in the dustbin of history. Standing still is not an option.
Revealing the deepest secrets from space can inspire wonder, but they can also incite fear. This grainy image shows an asteroid called Bennu, and it may be on a collision course with Earth.
Odds of Bennu hitting the Earth are less than 1 in 2,000. That's still considered high for this class of object. Typical odds would hopefully be lower than 1 in a million.
Bennu is smaller than the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs, but it could cause a tremendous amount of damage in the local area where it hits. For instance, it could really damage something the size of a large city, or if it hit just offshore, it could create a tidal wave.
In September 2016, Bashar and Peter will send a probe to photograph Bennu in detail and reveal its secrets. But a mission like this is fraught with potential pitfalls. In August 2014, a spacecraft called Rosetta arrived at another small body, a comet caught in Jupiter's gravity. 3 months later, the Rosetta team attempted to land a probe called Philae on the comet's surface, and it ended in disaster.
Philae was equipped with a couple of harpoons so that when it made its landing, they would shoot out and ideally try to moor it there. Except that apparently, the harpoons did not fire when Philae landed.
So because of that, Philae hit the surface and bounced. And it bounced several times because of the comet's rotation and the lander's own velocity. And it wound up coming down in an area of the comet that we didn't have good maps for. And so basically, the lander was lost.
The team is determined to see their mission succeed. That's because there is more to learn from Bennu than whether or not it will collide with Earth. It could unlock the origins of life on our planet.
The Earth formed when objects slammed together. But later on, as it cooled and water became a large part of the surface composition, then it was possible for future impacts with smaller objects to actually bring in organic materials that could survive on the surface. That's how many people think organics came to the Earth, is through those impacts from asteroids. When we get a sample of Bennu back into our laboratories, we're going to be looking at material that formed in the initial phases of the formation of the solar system.
If we could someday prove that the building blocks of life on Earth actually came from space and not from our own planet, it would turn everything we understood about the origin of life on its head.
OSIRIS-REx will not attempt a landing like Philae. Instead, it will get a sample of the asteroid with a revolutionary new system called TAG-SAM.
TAG stands for touch and go, and SAM is sample acquisition maneuver. So TAG-SAM is the actual act of reaching out, touching the surface of the asteroid, and gathering the sample, and then pulling away.
Once samples from Bennu arrive back on Earth, we can test them for the kinds of organic materials that could have seeded Earth 4 billion years ago. But to successfully retrieve the sample, the cameras must function perfectly.
The cameras are one of the critical experiments on this mission because as we get closer, it can refocus and actually becomes more like a microscope. And it can detect grains that are just a few millimeters across. So when we get to our sample site, we want to get the highest resolution possible.
The OSIRIS-REx camera suite consists of three cameras, low resolution, medium resolution, and high resolution cameras with overlapping functions that are meant to carry out or fulfill the requirements for imaging for the mission.
We're trying to get deeper and deeper into how the cameras work. The reason we're doing this test is to find out how the camera responds to different colors. Because when we get to the asteroid, we want to know, when we take color pictures, what the true color of the asteroid is.
Different minerals have different signatures in this manner. Like, for example, rust is orange. Olivine crystal, which you can find in sand and volcanic glass, can be orange or yellow or green. And so just by looking at the color of an object, you can actually sort of tell what it is very roughly. And the more finely you can parse out those colors, the more narrow the color you can look at, the better you can tell what an object is. So by mapping colors of light, they'll be able to say, where is the best place to send our probe so that we can get the most scientifically interesting material that we possibly can to bring back to Earth.
All right, can you hear the light? What we're about to do here is we're about to start a scan where we're going to change the color of the light that's being sent into this sphere that the camera is looking at. And then the camera is going to be taking pictures of the light, different colors, as the light is being scanned to characterize how sensitive it is to those different wavelengths.
In the last month and a half, we've had about 15 different major tests. And I think that having been successfully completed produces a big sigh of relief in everybody involved. The things that keep me up all night are big things, things that we missed during the calibration. You don't know what you don't know. We are in an ever-present position of trying to get rid of our fears and uncertainties about what might happen.
With only months to go until liftoff, the clock is ticking to get OSIRIS-REx right.
We'll be launching in September of 2016. So we have a schedule pressure here that I think does take its toll on the team. There are a number of things that we're trying out for the first time, and that keeps people up at night at NASA.
Should the mission fail, NASA will need another way to reach Bennu. Scientist Ben Hockman created a backup plan, and to test it, he's hitting the beach.
I think most people assume asteroids are just big rocks in space, when in fact they have very interesting surface geology. We've found through recent missions that there can be a wide variety of different surface features.
With its mix of sand and rocks, this beach mimics terrain that NASA has observed on comets and asteroids. It is the perfect place to test Ben's rover, nicknamed Hedgehog.
Hedgehog is a whole new class of rovers, very different from the previous rovers that we've sent to the Moon and Mars. We've seen that the topology of asteroids can be very uneven, so there's potential that a rover could fall into a pit or a crater and be unable to escape. All right, hopefully this works.
It may not look like much, but on an asteroid, where gravity is a tiny fraction of the Earth's, this same hop would propel Hedgehog far across the surface.
It uses three internal flywheels to build up momentum internally, and by doing that, it can hop and tumble across the surface.
These spinning flywheels build up momentum, and when Ben applies the brakes, he transfers that momentum into motion.
Think about it like you're driving your bike and you come to an obstacle and you hit your front brakes. You have a lot of momentum about your front wheel, so you have a tendency to want to flip over your front wheel. The same is true for Hedgehog, but we do that to our advantage to hop in a controlled way.
But to see how Hedgehog will work in a near zero-G environment, Ben must head to the lab at Stanford University.
So this contraption is called our microgravity testbed. The microgravity testbed allows us to emulate what the rover might do in actual microgravity conditions.
The bed shows Ben how Hedgehog will behave on an asteroid like Bennu.
At those scales, gravity is about 1,000 or 10,000 times lower than that of Earth. So on an asteroid, a human would weigh as much as a paperclip.
One of the key advantages of Hedgehog is that there's no right way up. In other words, it can land on any side and be just as capable of moving as if it were to land on its feet, so to say.
And Hedgehog holds one other advantage.
Because Hedgehog is so compact and cheap, you can store potentially many of them in a spacecraft that you send to a small body. So you could imagine an army of hedgehogs hopping around the surface, exploring the physical properties of an asteroid.
For now, Hedgehog is only a prototype. So it will be up to OSIRIS-REx to unlock the secrets of Bennu. The answers won't come until late 2018, when OSIRIS-REx and its cameras finally reach the asteroid.
I think the images of Bennu are going to be revelatory. Waiting for those images to come back in 2018 and 2019 will be, the only thing I could compare it to would be the waiting for the births of my two children. Because it's something very important to you, and you're not quite sure of the outcome.
Until then, scientists can only wonder if Bennu will change our understanding of life on Earth.
How did all that get going? Did it start here, or was it brought here from outside? We don't really know the answer to that. We're gonna go find out.